All right, this is the deck we're playing in this league. This is Red White Painter, also known as Strawberry Shortcake. The list that I'm playing is, it deviates in a few ways from what the typical Strawberry Shortcake list that you might see would have. The mana configuration is a little bit different. I have less fast mana, only three Lotus Petals instead of four, no Lion's Eye Diamond. I'm also a little bit heavier on lands accordingly, five mountains instead of four. Still the one Symphony of the Spirit Guide. Playing only three Urza Saga instead of four. For a couple of reasons. So one of them is that this deck is a little bit lighter on artifacts than other painter lists that you might see. The constructs tend to be a little bit small, not that effective at actually winning the game. But mostly it's because I'm playing a copy of Blood Moon. I just want to not have too much awkwardness between my own Urza Sagas and my own Blood Moons. So in order to make this Blood Moon effective with only one copy, you're playing a couple of Enlightened Tutors, which is more than you usually see. Usually you see zero, maybe, or one in the main deck. And another deviation, I'm playing three main deck copies of Karn. Karn's kind of fallen out of favor in the main deck. You usually see fewer copies than this because you have these Urza Sagas that they're not permanent mana sources. They eventually go away. That can sometimes make it difficult to cast four drops. But I find that Karn gives me a lot of angles to fight in games that go long. And on that note, in order to make that happen, I have a lot more artifacts in the sideboard to get with the Karn than you often see. So the artifacts that are usually kind of typical are these. So, Spare Canonist, Portable Hole for Removal, Fourth Grindstone, Pithy Needle, Staring Bridge, Tormod's Crypt. I got an additional item of graveyard interaction. Mostly this is for Uro, because it really doesn't feel good to have to use the Tormod's Crypt and spend the card to deal with the Uro that already recouped the card for the opponent. And when you only really need to exile the one card anyway, Solgaea Lantern's a lot more a pinpoint. And since you can cash in to draw a card, that can be extremely relevant. I've got Liquid Metal Coating here to help pressure the mana base. Pretty much any matchup where Blood Moon is a lockout, a Liquid Metal Coating can also be good. There are some fringe synergies where you say you turn your own City of Traders into an artifact and then sacrifice it with a goblin before its sacrifice trigger would go on the stack to play due to playing another land. Sometimes that comes up. But mostly, one of the best things about Liquid Metal Coating is that if you have a hand that produces a fast Karn, you can immediately fetch Coating with it, and then if you untap with Karn, you can immediately start destroying the opponent's lands. So that allows you to turn a fast Karn or a Karn on an empty board into a way that might actually be game. And the last card here is this Brazed Apprentice, which is a card that I'm still somewhat experimenting with. The motivation for including this is that it's a card that's very good in matchups where you expect a lot of removal, matchups where you have to grind. Usually, when you have goblins, the way that those play out is that you swap one card for another, but you never actually accumulate resources. You just kind of fight through the removal of the opponent would have. Brazed Apprentice, you can still swap it back and forth, but since it brings a copter along with it, and since it is itself an artifact, you actually accumulate resources the more that you swap it with goblins. And in addition to that, it's sometimes convenient to have flying attackers or flying blockers. Being able to somewhat draw a card with this exile top card ability can be extremely relevant in any matchup where card advantage matters. And sometimes, I've had it come up where it's helpful to just give a Thopter plus two and start hitting three in the air. So that's the last of the Karn artifacts. The rest of the sideboard, a couple of search tools for more graveyard hate, additional blasts for matchups with lots of blue cards or Force of Wills. Rip Apart is mostly there for Chalice, but it has some fringe applications against Sylvan Library or some Planeswalkers. And two additional bolts to complement the two in the main deck. Any matchup where I want to kill a one-drop creature, we bring in two additional bolts. So this is a concession to Ragavan, mostly. And that's basically the deck. So we'll play five rounds and see how it goes.